Good to see everyone once again, and it's a delight that you're here, and thank you for coming, and those watching online, we're so glad that you could be here, and if you've overslept this morning, I completely get it. I really like fall. When we get an hour of sleep, it's not fun when they take an hour away from us, but the good news is there's more daylight that we can enjoy now, right? Well, not more daylight, but more daylight in our waking hours, so we're excited about spring is on its way, and to celebrate spring, we're having another nor'easter coming our way, so I don't know about you, I'm excited about that. Well, it's so good. Before we get into our series, I just want to mention a few things. Easter is on its way, as you might be aware of. It's going to be April 1st, and it's just an amazing opportunity. Most folks will come to church if you invite them on Easter. And so we provided these inside your bulletin, and what it basically is, it's all in for Easter, and we're asking you to maybe pray for five or six or more people and ask them to come to church with you and say, hey, what service would you like to go to? We have the 8:30 10 and 11:30 on Sunday, and we have Saturday at 4. And so encourage them to come. And according to statistics, as you can see on your little card, 88% of people will say yes. And so we encourage you to do that. And if you could also let us know what service you're going to. We have a feeling that a lot of folks will probably come to the middle service, the 10 o'clock service. If you could, you know, either go to the first or the last or the Saturday, make room, that would be great. And when you ask someone to come, ask them, what service do you want to go to? Let them choose for you, okay? We're believing to reach more people than we ever have on Easter. It's a great opportunity, and so that's what's going on, okay? That's what's going on. And also today, we have Growth Track Step 2 and Find Your Gift. Love for you guys to come to that as well. It's at 1 o'clock. It's about an hour or so. Well, back to our series called Uncommon Relationships, and really the quality of our life is measured by our relationships. And perhaps one of the most challenging things that you and I go through is communication. It's when you think about communication and how we speak and how we communicate, it seems like the more technology we have, the less we communicate. It seems like, you know, a lot of people now, they communicate through Snapchat or Facebook or text messages, and emails are almost like a has-been, right? And so is Facebook if you're under 40. So it's just amazing how with all this technology of communication, it seems that we communicate less and that we don't really pay attention to what we're saying because people now are just electronic devices and you can say whatever you want to say and there's no consequence because you're hidden behind a screen miles away. And we kind of depersonalize. And so it's amazing, even sociologists and psychologists tell us that even though we have all this communication, we're actually more lonely than we were before we had all the cell phones. It doesn't make any sense. Well, we should be leading the way in communication, and communication is so important. It's part of what God has created us to do. We're going to be talking about today how to have uncommon communication. The truth is, most relationships don't go well. It's uncommon for relationships to go well. So we're going to look about communication today. But before we do that, I want to just kind of remind us about what we've been talking about. This is the fifth week now. We have one more week next week where we talk about actual conflict. And I don't know if you've ever seen a boxing match, but they usually tell you, there's certain rules, how to fight, and we're going to be talking about fighting next week, so make sure you bring your helmets. Anyhow, God made you for relationships. He really has. He's made you and I to relate to each other, beginning with him. He's the author of all relationships. So if we want our relationships to be healthy, ultimately, we need to get right a relationship with God. And because God has always been, he always will be in communion. He was from eternity and he is to now. So God made us relationships. We mentioned that. Other thing we mentioned is that every good and perfect gift comes from God. God is the author of everything good and wonderful is coming down from him from the Father of lights. We've been talking about that. And that all love, all grace, actually all relationships ultimately find their foundation and their genesis in God, because he's our creator. And so we mentioned the spaghetti strainer and how you have all those different holes and the water goes through it. And we mentioned that God is the Father of lights, and every relationship, every love relationship, it's going to remind you what we've been talking about, comes from him. And so we've been talking about, as a way of illustration, that these holes represent different aspects of our relationships. For example, between a husband and a wife, a child and a parent, a mother and a father, whatever, your friends. And these represent different attributes of all relationships that come from God. And what happens is you and I tend to focus on these little holes and think, I don't feel whole. Of course not. Because nobody can take the place of God. And if we want to have good relationships, ultimately it all begins with having a good relationship with God. He is the epicenter of all relationships, and so we want to build our lives upon him, and not, these things are fine. My wife is fine, you're fine. So this is what we've been talking about. And the two main pitfalls we've been speaking about week after week now is this. The biggest pitfall is this, expecting others to do only what God can do. Let me tell you right now, if you're single and you want to get married and you're thinking, once I get married, I'm going to be, he or she is going to, no, I hate to tell you that. It will for a while. I'll guarantee you that, because you'll be intoxicated with love. I love her. You're so beautiful. And then it wears off. And real love gets deeper. But the problem is, you are flawed and I'm flawed. We're not perfect. God's perfect. And so if we expect perfection from each other, it's called idolatry. You're making someone and trying to get someone to do only what God can do. Only God is perfect. Only God can fulfill all of your needs. And so talk about pressure. You want to have a good relationship, realize God is my source. Now, once you build it upon that, then you can truly love your children, your spouse, your friends. Why? Because you understand. You're not going to try to extract something out of somebody that they cannot give you. I'm not God and neither are you, right? So, expecting others to do only what God can do. I'm telling you, this is a huge secret. If you can't be happy by yourself, you will not be happy married. I'm telling you, guys, I'm telling you. If you can't be happy without having children, you're not, listen, there's nothing wrong with those things. But if we look to people and circumstances to meet only what God can do, we're going to be running forever trying to find fulfillment when ultimate fulfillment comes in God. I hope you understand what I'm trying to say. It's huge, huge concept here. Here's another problem, pitfall. Expecting others to do only what you can do. You can't control people. You barely control yourself, right? So, you know, have these two things in mind and realize that God is the utmost of all things. And so, and now we're talking about the tongue. And I have to be transparent with you this morning. This is a very difficult topic for me to talk about because I'm still in process with this. I grew up in Long Island, New York. Fast-talking, wise-cracking, you know, kind of kid. And I was also the youngest of the two older brothers. And so the only way I could win an argument, I couldn't win with my strength. One guy's 7 years older, the other guy's 4. So I had to fight with my tongue. So I learned how to, you know, be quick and say things. And just a little secret for those of you that are young and have older brothers or sisters, what you need to do is you need to exaggerate if you get hit by your brother or sister. They touch, you know, I used to do all that. So I was good at that. Also in Long Island, talker, right? And we were sarcastic, get a lot of jokes. And so we just kind of threw stuff around. To make matters worse, I'm Italian. We tend to be a little bit, you know, verbose. And so I'm Italian. And then I'm German with all the gutturals. You know. So you put that with an Italian and a New Yorker from Long Island and the youngest, you got a problem. So I'm still in recovery. Okay? And believe me, I struggle with this, and I don't say this as I've mastered, but this is something the Lord brings conviction, and conviction's a good thing. And let me just say something very interesting. I'm talking about this topic. It's perhaps been one of the worst weeks I've had in over a year with my mouth. I told off a police officer. I got thrown in prison. I'm just kidding. That did not happen. But seriously, it's been a tough week. I've actually said, what is wrong? I feel so unqualified how I've acted. Now, it wasn't that bad, per se. You might say, what's the big deal? It is a big deal because I know better, right? And I believe I came under the enemy this past week because I'm trying to talk about this topic that is a very important topic. And I don't come in my own authority. I come in God's authority. But I'm telling you, one thing I encourage you to do when you fall, get back up immediately and get right with God and get right with the person. I will say we do that in our household. We don't let days go by, weeks go by, or even hours go by. We fail, we take ownership, and we get right. But this is a big issue. Our tongues, how we speak, is such an important thing. Okay, all creation, we're made in God's image, and God spoke and life came. We're made in his image, and But we have power in our tongue to create and destroy. Now, don't get crazy about it and think we can just say it and it happens. No, but there's something that God listens to our tongues. Why does God ask us to pray out loud? And why?
Because he's given us an amount of authority with our tongues and how we speak. And so, listen, God wants our tongues to be surrendered to him. So death and life are in the power of the tongue, and those who love it will eat of its fruits. You can eat bad or eat good from it. And so I love what four levels of communication, and I got this from a couple sociologists online, and I thought it was fantastic, and I agree with them. Okay, and it's basically this, and they're Christian authors, surface communication. This is absolutely true, and most people will tell you this. Any communication course, they're going to tell you these things. The first thing is surface communication. What's that? Hey, how you doing? Praise God. Doing great. Praise God. Even that. Praise God. Hey, how you doing? Good. Great. How you doing? Fantastic. You wave at your neighbor. You've been there for 10 years. You had never had more than three sentences, but you wave at your neighbor. When he goes down the street, you wave in the car, you know, and all that. You wave at everybody. I remember being in Texas selling books door-to-door, and everyone's so friendly down there. A lot of surface communication. Everyone waves to you. I even started waving the dogs. So we got this surface communication, just being nice, and there's not real depth in it. There's nothing wrong with it because you can't know everybody, but it's just kind of a surface thing. There's not really any depth in it. And really, you're only able to have 15 to 20 close relationships, even that. Even Jesus, he had the 120, he had the 70, he had the 12, he had the 3, and he had the 1. So he has surface communication. Another one is would be general information. These are people that would say, hey, how you doing? How's the weather today? And what do you do for work? I do this or the other. Oh, great, great. Yeah, how about those Yankees? How about those Red Sox? And you talk about the weather, all the weather, this, the weather, that. And sometimes it comes general information. And this can happen at work. I need you to do this project by the X amount of days, right? And this can happen in a marriage. You get so busy. I'm park cart, the kids to here, to here, taekwondo, and soccer, and baseball, and the basketball, or whatever you're doing, and the next thing you know, you see your spouse, how you doing? I'm picking the kids up. Okay, I'll meet you halfway. I'll wave at you on the highway. I'll be going on 84. You wave going the other way, and you're just like, you talk to each other, you say, how you doing, sweetie? Fine. And you're sleeping, and it seems like all you have time for is general information. This can happen in a relationship. And when that begins to happen, you start getting further and further from each other. So nothing wrong with it per se, but we really don't want to be this way with our close relationships, right? Just general information. This is what begins to happen. And then we also have the next level of this, and when you really start knowing somebody, it's called deep feelings. When you begin to explain how you feel, not what you know, but how you feel. How you doing? How's work, man? I'm really concerned at work because they're laying people off. There's a merger going on. There's talk about that. They're letting go of the older employees and hanging on with these young whippersnappers. And I'm beginning to wonder what's going to happen. Or I don't know what's going to happen. I'm in high school. I'm in 11th grade. Everyone's going to these schools. I have no idea what I want to do with my life. I feel pressure to go to college, but I want to be a mechanic. And my parents are putting I don't know what to do. And you share your feelings, right? I feel lonely. When you share your feelings, what happens is it draws you closer to somebody because you're beginning to do that. Now, another thing is this. Feelings are not always right, but they're real. I had to learn this the hard way. Feelings are not always right, but they're real. I'm scared of that. Why? Don't be scared. That's stupid. You just tell the person they're stupid, right? That doesn't help a person. So listen, what we need to do is when you're in communication with somebody is say, listen, I understand what you're feeling is real. So for example, you say to somebody, you make me sick. You make me angry. And what happens is immediately in the communication, you're going to put up your dukes and try to fight that because they're claiming you make them angry. No one makes you angry. You choose to be angry. They may give you a lot of opportunity to grab onto it, but we have to start taking responsibility for our feelings. How much better is it to say, listen, when you come home late, and you don't return my text messages and phone calls, I feel like you don't care about me. No, I do care about me. That's how I feel. Versus, you don't care about me. You make me sick. You don't even answer my text messages. That's a conflict waiting to happen, right? But if you take ownership, say, when you do this, I feel that way. Well, you shouldn't be feeling that way. No, listen, the feelings may be wrong, but please hear a person out. If a person's going through difficulty, even Job's friends, they sat with him for a couple of weeks before they started talking. But feelings are not always right, but they're real. Let a person express how they feel, even if it makes no sense. It's called drawing close. Look, King David said, my soul is I'm broken, God. He cries out to God. Even Jesus cries out to God. And he says, my heart is broken. It's okay. When you share feelings, you get closer. Think about it. Some of the closest relationships I've had in my life has been with people that have walked with me through difficult sets of circumstances. That's what draws you close. So don't limit the opportunity for that. Don't be quoting and saying, that's wrong, that's right. Let a person talk. Now, later on we can deal with it. But people need to be heard. And so we do have that feelings. Rejoice with those who rejoice and weep with those who weep. So we have surface communication, which is in the utmost. We have general information. We have deep feelings. And we have deep needs. Deep needs. Not only are there feelings, but there's needs. Some of us have needs. We all have needs. All right? And so we need to know how to meet each other's needs. We mentioned last week, according to Ephesians chapter 5, that husbands see that you love your wives. And why see that you respect your husband? We mentioned that there's a fundamental need for women to feel loved and appreciated and treated as special in a nice way, while men need to feel loved by respect. And so we need to meet each other's needs. We need to understand the deep needs. Or I need to know what's going on. Maybe someone's thinking about, I'm getting older now, the kids are ready to leave, and or retirement's coming, what's going to happen? Or maybe you're trying to figure out what's going on with your schooling or whatever. So we have these deep needs, and so that's all part of communication as well. Deep feelings and deep needs, to be able to share those needs and not disparage those needs. See, the Bible says, do not be selfish. Don't try to impress others. Be humble, thinking of others better than yourself. Don't look out only for your own interests, but take an interest in others too. Bible says, carry each other's burdens. Bear one another's burdens, and so fulfill the law of Christ. I love to see when I see going on in our church. Someone is sick or someone's going through a difficult time, and spontaneously, because you're involved with small groups, because you know people, people start bringing meals over, people start talking to somebody. Oh, I went to the hospital, I visited this person. You're texting people, you're loving on people, and you're what you're doing? You're meeting each other's needs. You're helping to bear, help each other with the burdens. And so sometimes you'll be strong and I'll be weak and vice versa. And so this is what Jesus would do. He would bear the burdens with people. He would, at one moment, he would actually cry. I mean, he was going to heal Lazarus, who died. And when he went there, Martha and Mary, they're crying, and he weeps. But he knows he's going to raise him from the dead. He joined in to their pain and sympathized and empathized with them. So that's one of the things we do. And I like what Dr. Markman and Stanley did, an excellent book on communication. And they talk about four barriers of communication. And this really, you can see it in a lot of the scriptural texts as well. First one is this, withdrawal. We actually withdraw. If I get upset, I'm gonna cold as ice. I'm gonna cut you off. I'm gonna step out of the circumstances. I'm not gonna be involved. I'm gonna withdraw. I'm done with you. You're finished. And you just kind of close the door of your mind, of your emotions, and you shut someone out. You're just too much of a hassle. It's too painful. I'm gonna withdraw from you. And this is one of the barriers in marriage as well. You ever done this, guys? Ladies and gentlemen, you're married. You know, you get in an argument with somebody, your wife, and you're on one side of the bed and you're on the other. We don't have the luxury of we don't have a king side, we have a queen. And you know, if her heel even touches me, she loses. So we're like this, right? You know, withdrawing from each other. That can happen as well. And then you have something else withdrawing, then you have this escalation. It starts to germinate. And by the way, you know what they've done studies? They have found out this. When a man's heart rate gets to 100, he stops thinking. So everyone should get a Fitbit and have like your spouse's or friend's heart rate on you. Oh, he's at 100. Forget about it. Listen, I'm serious. What begins to happen, you start feeling threatened, and literally a part of your brain that's called fight or flight takes over, and the blood goes there, and the blood for rational thought gets shut down. That's why the Bible says a soft answer turns away wrath. So you have escalation. You start, you know, getting ethnic. If you're like me, get a little ethnic. You get a little upset. You start raising the temperature. Once you start raising the temperature, you're not thinking clear anymore. Right? Sometimes it's best just to walk away for a period of time. So we have withdrawal. We have escalation. And then we have this one, belittling. If I can't win, I'm going to knock you down. You know,
I can't win this argument. Well, you always do that. And you start talking about the person's faults. And this happens in any relationships that are close, right? And I reminds me of a couple that were driving, an older couple. They were angry with each other, driving in the car, not talking to each other. And he goes through a small little town, and he passes by a farm, and he sees pigs and donkeys and chickens. And he goes to his wife, "Are those your relatives?" And she goes, "Yeah, my in-laws." So we tend to belittle each other. And that's not a way to go, you know. These are all four barriers to communication. And then finally we have this one. We have, this is the one that's really a problem here, called false belief. This is when it gets demonic. I'm serious. This, I'm not trying to overemphasize or underestimate, but the truth is, when we start dealing with lies and false beliefs, you start believing you can never achieve something. You start believing that you're so dumb, you never choose anything, you're not college material, you never have a good relationship. All these negative comments maybe your spouse or your family or parents have said to you, this gets on you. If you start believing those false beliefs, or you start believing my husband doesn't love me, my wife does not love me, and she does or he does, but you start believing that, what happens is you start thinking the false beliefs are true. And the truth is the enemy, the devil, he was a murderer from the beginning. He's not standing the truth because there is no truth in him. When he lies, he speaks out of his own character. He is the father of lies. So be very careful of what we speak, especially if it's not true. If you say something long enough, this is the scary part. If you speak a lie long enough, there's a spiritual component. The enemy is like, cool, the father of lies, they're in my world. The demonic realm will attach itself to it. Then, to make matters even worse, those false beliefs go from your conscious mind to your subconscious mind. Your subconscious mind does not know the difference between reality and unreality, or reality and reality. Unreality and reality. I can't say it right. Next service, I'll get it right. He doesn't know what's true and what's not true. And so you can believe a lie. So your emotions believe a lie. So now your emotions are releasing chemicals in your head to make you feel emotions. And it's like, wow. But the truth is, you can be renewed by the renewing of your mind, okay? But these are things that begin to happen. This is the progression we see begin to happen. So our words, my friends, matter to God. They really matter to God. You're made in his image, and what you speak is very important. We should be the leaders in communication. And this is the truth of the matter. This is what Jesus had to say. And this is a paraphrase by Eugene Peterson. I'm not normally a big fan of his, but I actually read this passage and I looked at this, and it does a great job actually extracting what the actual verse says in the Greek. And this is what this is really good. Listen to what Jesus had to say, paraphrasing in today's culture. Let me tell you something, Jesus says. Every one of these careless words is going to come back to haunt you. There will be a time of reckoning. Words are powerful, my friends. Words are powerful. Take them seriously. Words can be your salvation. Words can also be your damnation. The Bible says if you call your brother Raka, you're in danger of the fires of hell. You're thinking, well, good, I never call my brother Raka. Well, Raka means an idiot. And what do we see right now in our political discourse? Horrible. People saying like stuff with tweets and text messages and little blogs and news stories that I read online. I don't try not to watch the television. They keep talking forever about the same thing. So I read the news stories and I'll see the little comments on the bottom. The things that people are saying, and we have such insulation. I'm in my basement or I'm in my car. I'm behind my phone. And so I'm going to say something horrible about somebody I never even know. We dehumanize people. And what begins to happen is the Bible says every careless word, that scares me. I've said a lot of careless words, and so have you. The good news is this. If you bring it before the Lord, Lord, cleanse my mouth and confess your sins to him, he will do that. But our words matter to Jesus. And we have to take more weight of our words. It used to be in the older time of Christ, when someone gave an oath, it was as good as a contract. My grandfather's generation, when they shook a hand and said they were going to do something, it's like a written today. People just say words, just say words. We're so flippant with our words. And we're accountable to that. So we should say, God, I'll give my tongue to you, God. I'll give my tongue to you and surrender your tongue to him. You see, we're the product of the words that were spoken over us.
Listen, I may not have grown up like you. I grew up in a pretty good home, a really good home. My parents said a lot of good things. You can do it, Eric. You're blessed. You know, my wife and I, we speak over our children every day. Genesis 12, 1 through 3, we speak the Abrahamic blessing on them. I will make your name great. You'll be a great nation, you know. You're going to change the world. God's with you. We start saying words of truth, words of life. You know what it does? It just builds you up. And see, we are the product of the words. And maybe you've heard bad things, and people might have said things accidentally, not even realizing a parent's tired on a rough day. A kid comes over. Oh, you're such a klutz. You never do anything right. The little kid hears that. You said it flippantly, not even meaning it. But it sinks in its subconscious. The devil goes, great, I got a lie to hang on to. And then this poor child begins to develop that. So we have to be very, very, very careful what we speak. Prophetic words are to build. The enemy knows that. So he can get us to prophesy doom and gloom upon each other. We're a product of the words we're spoken. We should speak good about each other. Speak life into each other. I've been guilty of it too, everybody. Why is it the people we love the most were the sloppiest with our words? Because all day I got to hold it together at work. I got to hold it together wherever I go. And then I come home, let our guard down. And then all of a sudden the enemy whispers in your ear, says something, you say it. I'm telling you, my friends, we need to take stock of our words. And it makes a difference what we say. You see, how do we communicate life to people? How do we communicate life? I like what George Bernard Shaw said, the playwright. This is really truth. The biggest problem in communication is the illusion it has taken place. Is that not true? Yeah. Let's just stop here for a moment and think about communication. It's so imperfect. This is why I want to encourage you guys. We'll be talking more about the baptism with the Holy Spirit. And in even speaking a spiritual language, you surrender your tongue to the Holy Spirit and saying, God, it's not my mouth, it's your mouth. God, I need you to fill me. I need you, God, you know. And the single problem of communication is the illusion that's taking place. We have to say, God, I want you to take over my mouth. Lord, I surrender my mouth to you. The tongue is the hardest thing to control. The single biggest problem in communication is the illusion that has taken place. And the problem is this. You have a thought in your mind. I'm trying to communicate to somebody else. And this is what happens. For example, let's suppose you say, oh, the summer is coming. We have a lot of activities to do. Okay, the summer is coming. We have a lot of activities to do. Okay, so your experience in summer is when you were in summer, it was a horrible time. You were locked indoors all day long. Your parents were at work, and it was hot, and you had bad experience. You got into fights in the summer. So when you hear the word summer, you think, oh, no, it's going to be horrible. To somebody else, the summer means fantastic. So now someone says to you, the summer's coming, you have a lot of things to do. You say it to one person, and they're thinking, great, the summer's coming. Last day of school, the other person is dreading it. The emotions of the past come up, and now they're trying to listen to what you're saying, but they have about, maybe they're listening about 70% or so, but they have like a 30% or more is in their mind of an emotion of that word you spoke and a memory. Or maybe someone reminds you of your old teacher in third grade. And the person was a great person, so you like them immediately. We don't realize that we got stuff going on in our mind. Or how about this? You're thinking, I got to pay my kids. I got to pay the bills, and I'm not quite sure we're going to make it. My mother's in the hospital, and you're thinking all those things. Now someone talks to you, and you're divided. You got a couple programs running in your head, and so it's very hard to listen, right? And then we hear something, and we take. Oh, this is what they mean by that. And then another thing that happens is you and I, we think we're mind readers. Like, I know what the other person's thinking. I know what the other person feels. No, you don't. We be very careful. See, a single problem of communication is illusion that's taking place. And so we'll talk about next week, the more heated the relation, the communication gets, the shorter the statements have to be, and they have to be reflected back. It's very important. Most of us are not really the best listeners. We think we listen better than we really do. I'm guilty of this. If you know me, I know how guilty I am of this. Especially with all these electronic devices, right? You're thinking, I got to go across here. I got to go to this location. I have to get in the car and go pick up my children from this, and then I'll stop by and I'll see somebody. I'm thinking about that. My pocket's buzzing. My wife's saying, get to pick up Hannah, whatever. And I'm trying to talk to some. I'm not really listening. You know, and it's very difficult. The best thing to say is, listen, I can't talk right now. Let's have a time. But what the problem is, you and I really don't listen very well. We don't realize it. And often when we're listening, look at what the Bible has to say. Understand this, my dear brothers and sisters, Book of James. You must all, everybody, we all struggle with it. We all may be quick to listen and slow to speak. You've heard this growing up. There's a reason God gave you two ears and one mouth. We need to listen twice as much as we speak. The problem with us, even if we're talking about sports and who got traded, and we're all excited. I want to tell you I'm excited about something. You're telling me what you're excited about. I'm not even listening to what you're saying. Right? But what would happen is a Francis of Assisi would said in one of his prayers, he says, Lord, help me to seek to understand more than to be understood. What happens if you think of a rebuttal. Someone's talking to you, and you meet somebody for the first time. I wonder what they think about me. Well, I'm an executive at such and such a firm. Oh, he's probably making about this amount of money, and look at the car he's driving. You're thinking of all these things, and you're measuring yourself to that person. You're thinking about, do I measure up? How can I say something that's intelligent in this conversation? You're thinking all that, and the person's talking to you. You're already thinking about what you can say back, and you're not even listening to what the person is saying. Now, that's on a trivial matter, but how about in a situation with the people you love or your children? The children come home, and they just had a rough day at the school bus, and they had a hard time at school, and people are being bullied. They come home, and then you tell them to do their homework, and then they kind of go off a little bit, and you talk to them. You're like, what's your problem? And meanwhile, you don't realize that something else has been going on, so try to listen between the lines, right? So communication is really difficult. Be quick to listen, slow to speak. So what best thing to do is stop trying to think of a rebuttal and say, okay, I'm going to listen. And so I love what Gary Chapman says. It's a great illustration. When you go to McDonald's or Chick-fil-A, wherever you go to the drive-thru window. It sounds like you're speaking to Mars sometimes.
Can I have this, man?
Yes, I'll have a Big Mac.
Is that chicken or chicken?
No, I said a Big Mac. You know, and so what do you do there, right? You state your order, and then the person reflects back what you said. And then you correct, making sure. So if I throw something to you, I want to make sure you catch it. And so this is very important that we need to say, now, what did I just tell you? Can you summarize what I just said? We have to communicate and make sure our message is getting across. A lot of misunderstandings, a lot of divorces, a lot of breakups are because of misunderstandings and miscommunication. And so be quick to listen and slow to speak. Let's be gracious. Let's be gracious to each other. Instead of trying to take, let me give you my full attention. So be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to get angry. Remember, guys, get over 100. You can't listen anymore. Human anger does not produce the word of God. Ephesians 4. Do not use foul or abusive everywhere you go now. Unbelievable, right? I'm going different places. People are swearing up and down, saying abusive things. He's such an idiot. He's such a jerk. This politician's, I mean, unbelievable. Don't use foul or abusive language. And so if we're watching TV programs where they're just dropping sarcastic comments and using swear, that gets in you. And the next thing you know, you start talking that way. It's dehumanizing, right? Don't let foul or abusive language. Let everything you say be good and helpful so that your words will be an encouragement. How many could be encouraged? To those who hear them. So we have to be careful what we speak and how we speak them. So here's some areas that we can do. I got this from Jimmy Evans, a great book on a marriage and how to build each other up. And he talks about this, and I think it's really great. He says, you need to praise each other. And I'm not suggesting you walk around, oh, how great you are, how great. No, I'm not talking about, no, don't do that. But praise, we all like to be encouraged. And so the Bible says, a word aptly spoken is like apples of gold and settings of silver. Listen, this is important. If you think something good about somebody, communicate it, please. I'm learning to do this more now. You know, Heike, thank you so much. You did an amazing job with the children. I don't know how you do. Thank you so much for being there for me. If you think of something good, say it, text it, spray it, whatever you got to do. Say it, think about it. All day, we're hearing negative words from the enemy. You can't do it. We're hearing this is too much for you. And people are longing for words of truth. And so God sometimes will give you a prophetic word. I'm not a prophet. If you're a child of God And you can learn to hear God. Sometimes God will give you something to say. You should really call this person and tell them you care about them. And you don't know that that comment at the right moment can bring a person to a whole other level. There was a situation where everything in my life fell apart. At least I thought so at the time. Right. My whole career, my engagement, it all fell apart. And I was thinking, I can't do this. And I heard Robert Spence, the president of Evangel College, who stopped me in the hall one and says, hey, you are a winner. I see God's hand upon you. And I remembered those sentences, and it pulled me up. Well, let me say something. I know we have Growth Track and all that, but we need more help with the children's ministries and teenagers' ministry. You know why? You can prophetically speak in people's life. NASA came to my office a couple of weeks ago, or a month or two ago, with this young boy, and he was so nice. I feel like the Lord said, prophesy to him. So I didn't go, oh, the Lord is showing me. I didn't do that. I said, you know what? I can see that God's hand's on your life. You're going to be something special. And I began to speak the words of life. And as I did, I got emotional. I sensed the Holy Spirit in the room. We can do that to each other. You can start speaking destiny in each other. You know? Everyone's longing. So ask the Lord. And if you'll start sharing God's words with people, God will give you more. It's beautiful. We can bring life where things are not. Prophecy is just hearing from God and speaking it out. That's all it is, everybody. It doesn't have to be spooky, right? We don't have to act weird and wear a robe and have a staff and, you know, be a Jedi Knight. You just be nice, right? A word aptly spoken is like apples of gold sitting in silver. Here's another. Pray, give praise, give thanksgiving. How great. Thanking. Remember how good. Listen, this is the best antidepressant in the world, almost. The top five. Doesn't cost any money. It does a great job. Studies have shown being thankful. Bible says be thankful in all circumstances, right? Be thankful. Find something good. I mean, I heard of a woman that was so positive. This lady, Mrs. Johnson, was 85 years old, and she never said anything negative about anybody. And they said, we got to trip her up somehow. So they went to Mrs. Johnson. Mrs. Johnson, what do you think of the devil? They're waiting. And finally, she goes, he's really good at his job. We got to be thanksgiving. The tongue has the power of life and death, and those who love it will eat of its fruit. He who finds a good wife finds a good thing. Listen, guys, we're blessed. Tell your wives, tell your mother, tell your mom, you love her. I mean, thanksgiving, give thanks. Give thanks. Thanksgiving opens up a whole realm of God's glory in your life. I'm telling you right now. And here's another one. You got words of affection, then we have affection. Openly express affection. Look at your spouse and kiss them. No, I'm just kidding. But how about say words of life? You know what? I really appreciate you. You know, isn't it kind of weird? We're like, I don't want to share that. It's too mushy. We'll be quick to criticize. We'll be quick to show affection. Say, you know, I really appreciate you. And I can with all sincerity, I really appreciate you guys. It's an honor to be here. It's an honor to serve as a pastor here. It's an honor to bring the word of God to you. You guys are awesome. And I see such great potential in this church. And God is bringing this wonderful group of people together, and that the personality of our church is constantly growing and becoming more God. I mean, that's a good thing. Say good things, right? Find words of affection and telling your kids, I love you. Telling your wife, here, you want to blow your wife away, man? Look her straight in the eyes and say, honey, look her in the eyes for more than 5 seconds and say, honey, I love you. And if I could do it all over again, I'd marry you again. It'll be a good day in your house that evening. Affection, openly express. Look at your children in their eyes. You're a winner. You can do this. Look at someone that's going through a difficult time. Look them straight in the eyes. Give them words of affection. Openly express affection. And then finally, here's encouragement, right? Do not let any unwholesome come out of your mouths, but only what is helpful for the building up of others. If it's not going to build someone else up, don't bother. Well, what do you mean? You never talk about anything bad? No. But if you can't bring correction without building someone up from it, don't bother. Okay? So only what is helpful in building up of others. And then truth and love. Got to speak the truth in love. And the Bible says this. We speak the truth in love, growing in every way more and more like Christ. Ephesians 4:15. We speak the truth in love. You know what Jesus did? He said he was full of truth and he was full of grace. He caught the woman in adultery. You all know the story. Everyone quotes this. Even atheists quote this. He's without sin. Cast the first stone. And that's what he did to that woman.
They wanted to kill her. She was wrong. She was caught red-handed. My friends, you and I, we mess up a lot. And God will look at us and say, I don't condemn you. But he says to us, go and sin no more. Change your ways, right? And so what that's grace and truth. And so truth without grace is mean. It's just mean. Okay, let me say something else. Knowledge without love is dangerous. Think about that for a moment. Knowledge without love is dangerous. Nuclear power without love is dangerous. A gun without love is dangerous. Your tongue without love is dangerous. Love, knowledge and love put together equals truth. God's truth. Knowledge and love together equals truth. You see, truth without grace is mean. Grace without truth, it doesn't make a difference what you do. Just go ahead. Oh, I love you. You love me. We're going to sit at the bar and hey, boys and girls. You know, that's not what life's about. You know, grace without truth is meaningless. Grace and truth is medicine. If we just say, yes, what you're doing is wrong, but God has a better way for you. Neither do I condemn you. Go and sin no more. God heals a man. You better change your ways or something worse will come to you. So there's grace and there's truth. This is how we're supposed to speak to her. We are to bring correction. But if you can't do it in love, if you can't do it in grace, if you can't do it in truth, when you realize how much you've blown it and how much God has forgiven you, you're a lot more gracious to people. If you really understand who you really are without God. And finally, prayer. Listen, I was blown away by this. And I'm going to be careful how I say it because I don't want to say anything bad about an institution that I was part of. But I've known people throughout my time that were believers and Christian leaders, and I would talk to them, look for them for advice, and we talk and say, okay, see you later. They never prayed. So I made it my purpose. If I ever talk to anybody, we're going to pray. Because the last thing you need is me without God. Me without God is not very good. And so we should always look, hey, let's pray together about this. Let's pray about this situation. And that brings power. I keep my eyes always on the Lord. With him at my right hand, I will not be shaken. Therefore, my heart is glad, and my tongue rejoices, and my body, you know, to be rest secure. Praying. Listen, we should be praying together. Marriages that pray together stay together. I'm telling you the truth. Every day, pray. Pray with your children. Pray. Always bring God into it. Always bring God into your circumstances. It brings tremendous power. So I'm going to ask you to bow your head. I'm going to ask as the worship team makes their way up. How are you doing with your tongue? Well, I think all of us, no matter where you are today, we can improve. But God has given us the tongue to heal and to hurt. Well, let's pray right now. Father, I ask in Jesus' name, Lord, I stand here today, Lord, recognizing I need your touch. We all need your touch, Lord. We want our tongues, Father. You said, Jesus, in the Bible, that if we can control our tongue, we can control every other aspect of our lives. Lord, we want to surrender our tongues to you today. We want to surrender our tongues to you, Father. Lord, forgive us for speaking words that are hurtful. Hurtful words spoken against ourselves. Hurtful words spoken against others. Father, forgive us for being flippant with our mouth. And not being careful. Lord, you've given us the power to heal with our mouths. And Father, we want to be a blessing in how we speak. Father, I ask that that you touch mouths right now, Father. And we want to ask you to forgive us. And Lord, even if we have to go to people and say, listen, I've been wrong. Please forgive me for speaking out of turn. Father, we surrender our mouths to you today. Holy Spirit, fill our tongues. Let us speak your words of truth, your words of life in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. With every head bowed, let me ask you a question. The Bible said that every careless word that you say, you'll have to give an account for, and that your words can even bring you to hell. Because sin without Jesus equals separation. And Jesus died for us so we wouldn't have to have an eternity without him. How are you with Jesus? How are you with Jesus? Maybe you walked with him for a period of time, you've walked away, you're doing your own thing. To believe in Jesus does not do it, everybody. God's asking us. us, not only to believe in him, but to turn away from everything we know is wrong and surrendering, saying, God, I turn away. I can't do it on my own. I surrender to you. God's not waiting for you to be perfect. He's waiting for you to be surrendered. If you're willing to surrender yourself today and receive God's forgiveness for your sins today, today can be a new day. So maybe some of you walked away from God. You want to get right. Or others, you've never completely surrendered your life to Jesus. I can't think of a better time than now. Listen, today is the day of salvation. Don't put it off. Because if your heart's touching you, God is dealing with you. If you don't deal with God's calling, you'll begin to get hardened. Today is the day of salvation. I'm going to pray in a few moments. You want me to include you in that prayer? You say, Pastor, raise your hand. Pastor, I want to embarrass you and put you on the spot. You say, Pastor, I realize I want to give my life to Christ for the first time. Or I want to renew my life. Anyone see, show of hands this morning and say, I want to do it today. Today I'm going to get serious with God. Anyone today? Thank you. Appreciate that. Anyone else today? Real bold. Come on, let's be real this morning. Okay, let's pray. Lord Jesus, I want to thank you for saving me. For saving me on the cross. Thank you, Jesus, for taking away all of my sins. You paid for everything I've ever done wrong, whatever will do. I ask you right now to forgive me. I surrender my life. I resign from being in control, and I hand over ownership of my life to you. I declare my life is no longer my own. Now forgive me, I pray, of all of my sins. And I choose, with your help, to walk with you these days forward in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. When you came in today, there was a connection card in the front pocket of your seat, also in your worship guide for those online. If you want to just fill that out in the front, it says, my decision today, I'm making a new commitment for the first time, or I'm going to commit today for the first time. You just fill that out. Now that we've done that, I think most people have elements. If anyone doesn't have an element, please let me know. Element, we're going to have communion right now. And, you know, the whole word communion means communication, communion, coming together. Anyone need anything, let us know. The ushers will take care of you. We'll have an offering in a few moments. You know what happened? Jesus wanted to have communion with us. It was impossible for us to come to Christ, to come to God without Jesus. Jesus had to be the price. And what did he do? He broke his body for us, that we be whole. So I want to encourage you right now. Anyone need any elements, just raise your hand. I'll just take care of it. He was broken that we could be whole. The Bible says, let a man or woman examine himself when they take communion. Because rightly dividing the word of truth, and also that we would discern the body of Christ. Do you realize, my friends, that you're the body of Christ? How I treat you is how I treat Jesus. How you treat your children is how you treat Jesus. How you treat your spouse is how you treat Jesus. And God has forgiven you. We have to forgive each other. Without the forgiveness of sins, there's no salvation. And God has forgiven you. As I've forgiven you, forgive each other, Jesus says. The Bible says if you do not forgive your brother from your heart, God won't forgive you. So I know you've been wrong against, I know things, situations happen, but if we're willing to forgive in faith, Jesus said, this is my body, which has been broken for you. Take, eat. After this sup, Jesus took the wine, which represents his blood. Without the shedding of blood, there's no forgiveness of sins. You see, God is a fair, God's a just God. There has to be justice. And he put every wrong thing you and I ever done, all our mistakes, he put it on Jesus. And by his blood, we're set free. What washes away our sin is the blood of Jesus. What heals us is the body of Christ. Let's all lift our cups for a moment. Father, we thank you. By your stripes, we're healed. I pray for healing right now in this place, Father. You are the God of miracles. Pray for healing of bodies, healing of mind, healing of emotions. Father, you are our healer. We receive you today. In Jesus' name. Another part of our worship today, we want to right now give back to the Lord, and that's all part of it. The Bible says, bring the whole tithe into the storehouse and test me and see if not, I will open the windows of heaven. Tithes are 10%. Offerings are beyond that. The God tells us that if we'll trust Him, He'll open the windows of heaven. And so I want to encourage you with that. God loves a cheerful giver. We just want to believe God. If you're a guest here today, do not feel obligated to give. But this is all part of us together, working together. Let's pray. Father, I pray you bless these offerings and tithes today. We want to thank you, Father God, that you will meet all of our needs as we trust you. Lord, we don't trust in our money. We trust in you. We thank you that you will provide all of our needs. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's go ahead and do that real quick. If you can put those cards in there, that would be great. I want to encourage you also, in a few moments, we're going to sing. We're going to have our prayer team come forward. Today at 1 o'clock, we're having a growth track, and it's called Find Your Gift. So if you want to figure out how you can fit involved in the church, we'd love to have you come. We'll give you a little test to help you figure out that you see only, and find your gifts, and get involved. Let's make a difference in each other's lives. And so I encourage you to do that today. We have child care and food. Come back at 1 o'clock. We get extra spots. Let's all stand if we could. As we're doing that, we're going to ask the prayer team to make their way down. If you need prayer for anything at all, we want to be able to pray with you. So let's go ahead and do that right now.
You guys, we love you. We'll see you all soon.